You've been bitten by a tick.
Oh, I forgot to turn my mic on.
Hello.
Folks, it's Check for Ticks. Are we the TV-est show on the internet?
Yes.
The radio-est show on the TV?
We're on the internet and the TV.
And the radio.
And the radio.
We're on all of them. We're on all the things. And you might notice we have a guest. He is a returning guest, triumphantly returning. He is Lou Taylor Pucci.
Hello.
Award-winning actor.
Yes. TV's Lou Taylor Pucci. Movies, Lou Taylor Pucci. Music videos, Lou Taylor Pucci.
Wow.
What else? Broadway. Have you been on Broadway or just off Broadway?
That was the first thing I did.
That was the first thing he did, was be on Broadway. Folks, Lou has done everything, including Check for Ticks twice.
Yeah.
So we're not sure where this goes on your IMDb, but I'm going to guess the very bottom.
I guess at the very top. I mean, like,
are we even on IMDb?
Yeah, okay.
I don't think we're on it.
Are we on it? No, we're not on it.
I don't think we are.
Why would we be on it?
I don't know.
So, Lou, I have to say, I saw one of your newest movies, because you have two movies out at once right now.
Yeah, really crazy.
Is that... the two of them are The Evil Dead, which is obviously a... Is it technically a reboot?
It's technically a remake. But I mean, like, they call it... What they're calling it for real is a reinvention and a reimagining of the original. Because it's just... It uses the same cliche characters that all the Cabin in the Woods type of movies are going to use.
Yeah.
And it uses the same story in a lot of ways. But, you know, this one is... completely different in that Bruce Campbell is not, you know, they're not trying to make an Ash character.
Yeah.
They're not trying to make him the hero or reinstate the old story. It's really, it's a new way of looking at it where the main character is like there for rehab. They kind of fixed plot holes and made it so that there's a reason that they even go to the cabin and that she would be seeing anything.
Yeah, that was true. She was like a heroin addict, right?
Yeah. And she's the heroine of the film.
Yes, she's the heroine with and without the E.
Oh, yes.
And that one, that was a good excuse for him to get the vomiting into the movie, too.
Oh, yeah.
Because if it's about heroin, you're like, I think you have to have vomiting.
Oh, yes.
That's the train spotting
role, I think.
On a detox
like that. I mean, like, that was a big demon blood vomit.
Yeah. Oh, no, I meant there's the demon blood vomit, but there's also just
the original vomit.
Yeah.
when the force comes out of the forest.
Yeah, the first vomit. So there was multiple vomits in the movie.
I didn't see the movie because Darren didn't call me.
Oh.
We didn't have tickets for you. It was just Jeff Raspy from 90.5 The Night. Jeff and I got tickets.
Whatever.
Darren. Whatever.
Could,
yeah. I feel bad because, like, right before the movie, this lady was like, are you going to the movie? And I was like, yeah. And she was like, oh, okay, because I was going to give you a ticket. It was Lou's mom.
Hell yeah.
Lou's mom was, and she wasn't even trying to scalp the ticket. She was just going to give me the ticket.
Yeah.
So, Lou, you have a very nice mom. She's very generous.
Thank you. Yeah, and thank God you can see the movie. It is going to be out for a while, hopefully. Yeah.
Hopefully.
I think it will.
Folks, it's the number one movie in the country. As of this being said.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Evil Dead is the number one movie in the country.
I was telling my friends, and they were like, they knew about it. Usually my friends are like, don't even. My friends are like, what are you doing? What's going on?
Yeah, I can't believe it. It's kind of one of those things that doesn't happen to be in a movie that is ranked. Everybody's going to see it. You know, it's sort of like having the number one song.
You're gonna see that movie whether you like want to or not. You're going to see that movie going into it like, I'm going to hate it. You know what I mean? Just because of like.
That's not how I went to see it, by the way.
Or like, you're going to like it.
Some people who are huge fans of the original, though, want to go and hate that movie.
Yeah, right?
They really want to get in there.
But you're still going to get those people in the theaters. You know what I mean?
They're still going to pay.
I think more of them, though, really just horror fans want to see good horror. That's it. And if it's good, then you won. You really did something good for them. Because as a horror fan myself, when you've seen almost all of them, at least all the big ones, you just... want desperately to see another good horror film, something you haven't seen before. This gives it to you.
Yeah, it was. Things were they were tough for you.
They were tough for me.
Lou takes. I don't know if I've ever seen someone get impaled by as many different things as Lou did.
I never.
Thank God they weren't fleshy, but they were all blunt.
Okay. You've been impaled by the second metal most objects. Things I've ever seen someone get impaled by in a movie. But it was like a recurring bit, James. Like, when you see the movie, like, once stuff starts stabbing Lou, it's just like every 10 or 15 minutes, he's getting something else. Something else. It's a hypodermic needle at one point.
Yeah.
Like a mirror.
Box cutter.
Yeah, like a nails.
Nails. Oh, yeah.
Sounds violent.
I had, at one point, I had this fake chest piece that they put on me that made me look super buff.
Mm-hmm.
It was really, really funny on the set. I walked around with this big... My nipples were sort of cockeyed because they didn't match up exactly.
Nice.
But they had to, like, make it look... So I'm walking around, and it looks like my chest, but it's just it's magically large.
Mm-hmm.
And
movie magic.
And huge gash in there with a pump somewhere under my... in an armpit that is pumping blood out of it for a whole day that we shot this one scene after I get stabbed with the mirror. And it's just when you look down at your chest where your heart is and there's just blood massively pumping out of it, there's no acting involved. You just get to really, really get scared.
Yeah.
So it was cool to work with practical effects. That was the biggest thing, the biggest part of it, is that we didn't do CGI with this film. They cleaned it up with CGI, but nothing, no effects were computer generated completely.
Yeah, I thought you were dead after the first stab.
Oh, yeah.
When he stabbed you there, I was like, oh, we're going to see Evil Dead Lou real quick after this because he's a goner. And then, nope, you were able to get stabbed by so many more things. But you gave out some good abuse before you got stabbed.
I sure did.
As
I
well.
Did. Nice piece of sink.
Yeah. That was the most painful part of the movie is probably Lou trips on a piece of face.
Mm-hmm.
And then lands back first on a toilet.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
And, like, I remember just being like, ah, as it happens.
Oh.
That was probably the only sympathy pain that I got. I think
oh,
cause
wow.
Because that was, like, that was, all, other than the fact that you were tripping on your girlfriend's face, it was very believable that could happen. Whereas with the rest of the stuff, you know, I'm not like, well, okay, a zombie's going to put a crowbar through my hand.
Right,
like,
right.
You just reminded
me of something that's really weird. I've never talked about this before with anybody, so this is exclusive stuff.
Exclusive.
But in the original script that I got, Olivia, the nurse, was supposed to be my girlfriend.
Okay.
She was my girlfriend. And that when you said your girlfriend, it was a mistake, but it reminded me that that's actually how it started. And then halfway through the rehearsals, they took my girlfriend away from me.
Oh.
And I was now just like the lowly teacher guy who opens the book and makes everybody die.
You certainly do that.
Yeah. Still got that part though.
What was your character's motivation for opening the book?
Why wouldn't you? I mean, honestly,
I wouldn't know because it was made out of human flesh and had barbed wires over it.
How'd you know it was human flesh? What if it was just some kids in a basement doing Satan rituals? You know,
okay,
what I mean?
And it was like cat flesh? I'm a vegetarian, so I guess it was just the flesh part that got me.
Cat flesh. I don't know. It definitely had hair on it and in it, so it was pretty nasty. I would say, well, I probably would have put gloves on, but I would have done it.
Did you get scared, like... Did you scare yourself?
He was scared when he saw his
that,
chest
that
wound.
Was probably the most scary part, to tell you the truth, was the flesh wound of the chest. When you look down at that thing and it really is pumping blood, it just scared the crap out of you. Because your heart really is like, oh, my God, I'm actually losing everything that's inside me. All my life is pouring out. That was pretty scary.
Speaking of scary stuff, like that segue, James?
Yes.
Has there been any backlash from this, like, directed at you, like, people on the internet saying, oh, you guys are all idiots for making this movie, we hate you?
I felt like that when I was, you know, before we made it. I felt like, okay, I'm not going to this audition. This is stupid. They should not be remaking this movie. It's a bad idea. Why remake something so perfect in its flaws? But when Sam Raimi, Bruce Campbell, and Rob Tappert, the original guys, were behind it, it started to get me, okay, that got me to the first audition, and I did terribly. It was a terrible audition. It was that scene where I'm sitting on the trap door, and just, I have to yell, you know, this, I don't think this is a panic attack here. I think it's the witchcraft in the basement. And
that was one of the laugh lines in the movie.
Yeah.
Nice.
So I
asked Darren, I was like, what were some of, like, the good, good lines?
Yeah.
Is witchcraft? That's one of my favorite lines in the movie.
Yeah.
And so that was the audition, terrible audition that I went on, but then the second one, Bruce Campbell was going to be there.
Wow.
So I went to that literally because I couldn't believe they wanted me for a callback in the first place, but also Bruce Campbell, I got to meet at the audition.
You just went kind of as a nerd.
Yeah, I went as a nerd, 100%, and asked him, you know, like, hey, all the nerd questions, sort of like, okay, so what's this movie going to be? Is it going to be campy, or is it going to be like a real, like the original Evil Dead?
Did you ask him if he really ever had a chainsaw arm?
No, that would be the ultimate nerd question. Where's your boomstick, dude?
Did you get to talk to Bruce Campbell before or after you did the second audition?
At the second audition, he was there.
Oh, okay.
And so he actually cast me, which is cool.
Wow.
I thought was really cool. He wanted to be a part of casting everyone. And I think it was part of it was probably, you know, just the fact that he's an egotistical badass. But at the same time, he is also one of the coolest people I've ever met in my life. He's like a talk show host, you know what I mean? He just kind of wants to be in the limelight no matter what.
Yeah.
And so he put himself there and had his casting be a part of the movie, which I thank. Because when Bruce Campbell cast you, you're like, mm-hmm. All right, maybe I can do it.
Yeah.
I believe awesome. You.
Did you ask him for his autograph at any point during that?
I sure did. I did about 3 times.
Before?
And I got it.
Wow. I would have...
And he's
they didn't
that
look
nice.
At that as, like, sucking up?
Not at the audition. Not the
okay.
audition. I didn't do it then. I got it after I got the movie. They couldn't fire me at this point.
Smart. That's yeah. smart. How bad was your bad audition?
It was pretty bad. One of the, you know, it's not even that I did bad. It was just a bad audition. Sometimes auditions just don't have any acting involved.
Mm-hmm.
It's like one of the casting director's notes, which is not bad about them. They didn't do anything wrong, but... One of their notes was, can you just say it really fast, just faster, like it's just spewing out of you?
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, ugh, it's the worst acting possible is, like, say it faster. You know, that's just the
yeah.
worst. There's nothing involved in that. It's just run your mouth out real fast. Blah, 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 blah. Like, you know, there's no drama to it. It's just kind of crap.
Yeah, because I only did one acting audition ever, and I was supposed to be a...
The one behind the couch? The one where I'm behind
oh,
the
no, two auditions.
Because I only did one.
All right, we'll get to the one that James and I did. But I did one where I was supposed to play a white drug dealer with dreadlocks in his 20s.
And you didn't get that job?
Completely blew it. Could
How
not have been
possible?
Any worse. I completely panicked and, like, forgot the lines. And then she was like, you could read them off the script. And I was like, then, like, I was just, like, so panicked. And, like, as I was doing it, I was like, I can't believe I'm blowing this.
Was
they wrote
other,
this part
was there
for
even
me.
Were other people in the audition?
There was, like the casting lady. So she's just reading.
No,
she's
but was
just
there
reading
other, was there other, like, white guys
Were you
with
reading
dreadlocks?
With someone?
No,
yeah.
there were no. The other white guys didn't
That's
even have
I mean, like,
close to dreadlocks.
Yeah, so how'd you.
Was it a dialogue scene, though?
Yes.
Talking to somebody?
It was a dialogue.
So they had a reader.
They had a reader there. It was for, like, one of those, like, CSI. It wasn't, like, CSI, but I was, like, some sort of, like, I was going to be, like, a street-level drug informant. So, like, the scene was, like, I'm, like, selling drugs, and then I see the female cop. And she runs after me. I run away. And then I get tackled and my hair goes flying.
Scene.
It was like an action scene.
Wow.
And then I'm supposed to get up and be like, oh, girl, why are you doing this? You know, like, I'm just trying to sell drugs. Like, why you got to ask me?
What you couldn't have just,
that was a lie?
You couldn't have just ad-libbed it?
I like, don't know.
You
I should be able to. I'm an improviser. But I just panicked so bad. And it was in Philly. And I found out about it the night before. And I was like, just like completely in a panic. And I was awful. That was the worst thing. And just as it was starting, I was like, can we please stop this? And she made me do it over and over, probably, because she was like, this is the only white guy with dreads that we have.
If those are the lines, it wasn't worth it anyway. Get out of here, woman. I'm just trying to sell drugs here.
Oh, it would have totally been worth it. So that was my audition. James, why don't you explain yours?
Ours was Darren and I were supposed to be in a, like a... We were supposed to be... The voices of puppets
mm-hmm.
in, like, a clearly... Sesame Street ripoff
yeah.
play. That was like going
That was going to be made
somewhere.
Into a TV show.
That was going to be like made into a TV show. And somehow, me and Darren and another comedian that was like, we go to this woman's house. And like.
It's not even her house.
It's, well, like, wasn't
it was
even her
friend's
house.
House.
It was just like, oh, it was just like, what is going on? And then literally at one point, it was just me and Darren. behind a woman's couch with the puppets, like, doing the audition.
Oh, my God.
For, like, this woman.
Yeah.
And, like, it was just... I couldn't read.
Yeah.
And, like, nobody's, like, a puppeteer. And
oh, my God.
It would have worked, like, as a, like, if somebody else saw that and watched that process.
That's
amazing. It was definitely entertaining.
I've never been a part of a puppetry audition before in my life. Yeah. That would scare the crap out of me.
We didn't get it.
But then she didn't even tell us that we didn't get it. And then, like, the next night at, like, midnight, we finally found out that we couldn't get it. And then she was like, I can't cast any of you in this because I just got diagnosed with cancer.
Oh, my God.
And then James said, well, yeah, having cancer is not like selling meat.
I don't know what that meant.
That is the strangest thing I've ever heard.
But we think that she made up the cancer thing. Because it was like...
Oh, my God.
We were over her house behind her couch until like 9 p.m. the one day. And then the next day, she's like, oh, yeah, I can't cast you in this. But like some of the clips are up on YouTube of the show. It was like a complete Sesame Street ripoff.
Oh, my God.
But again, we completely blew it.
I missed out. My big chance.
Missed out.
So Lou, you're in. That's The Evil Dead's the number one movie in
number
the country.
Number one movie in the country.
And then that's not the only movie that you have out right now.
Yeah, literally came out on April 5th, alongside, or not really alongside, but above the smaller indie film that I made 2 years ago, called The Story of Luke, about autism and about how, you know, the absurdity of life, and how autism is not so bad, and you can be a functional, more functional than many NTs, neurologically typical people. And
you
kind of shows a dysfunctional family how to live.
You play the autistic character in that film,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, pretty interesting. I mean, probably the biggest challenge I ever had, next to the pressure of remaking Evil Dead, trying to put a fictional autistic character on the screen that you believe enough to laugh with rather than at, is definitely the hardest thing I ever tried to do.
How were you scared as you were doing it that you were
going
to be offensive?
Every single day, every single second. All I would do is just, I had to trust the director at that point. And the director I could trust because he worked with autistic children for his entire life in some ways. He was brought up by a mother who worked with them. And in Peru, where she has an institute with over 500 kids who have developmental disorders. So basically, he knew his stuff.
Okay.
Good. And he could tell when you were being insincere about it in some way, or just, you know, it's not that I did this, but like sometimes you give nuances to things just because they might be entertaining or cool to look at or something. He wiped all that clean, and we came up with a good character that we did our homework for.
Did he make you feel bad about that? That you were doing? No. Was he like, come on, dude, that's not how they are?
No. I mean, a director kind of has to be your biggest advocate and best friend, mostly throughout anything that you do. You can't really have a big problem with the director, or else you got a big problem with the movie.
That makes sense. I heard, this is just something I'd heard about movies. I have no idea if it's true, because obviously I can't even play myself in an audition. Not that I sell drugs. I don't sell drugs. But I heard that the more fun that you have making a movie, the worse the movie turns out to be.
No, it's the opposite.
It's the opposite?
Well, no, I mean, okay, if you're the director and you're about just having fun, if that's your key ingredient, for me, that's probably the end result is going to be a crap movie.
Okay.
But as an actor, there's a lot of expressive energy inside of us that we don't use when we're not having fun. And I've only recently kind of enjoyed having fun on set. Usually I was so serious about everything I did. A lot of indie films, a lot of very introspective, kind of depressive, you know, moments in the films where he's crying or something. I mean, like, that's fun in some level, but this... Evil Dead, the only reason I got it was because I went into that audition and had as much fun as I possibly could.
Yeah.
And that's the truth. And the only reason that people like me in that movie is because I had so much fun making it. And if you don't, then it shows up. You don't allow the audience to laugh with you unless you're having fun.
Yeah. You were really good in Evil Dead, by the way.
Thanks, man.
I think you were, and I'm not even saying this because you're here and I'm sucking up to you. I thought that you were the best character in
Thanks,
the film.
Thanks, dude. I wish I lived.
I wish you did, too.
Oh, spoiler. Uh-oh. I do.
Yeah, but it was good. You got laughs, and I mean, obviously you were playing to a hometown crowd when I saw it.
Oh, yeah.
In Hazlitt.
How was that? Was that fun?
It was so fun. I've never done anything like that in my life. I've never done, had, you know, that sort of was like going to a theater production or something. Because I had my whole family and all the friends from New Jersey all sitting there actually applauding, you know, for something that I did. So it's kind of like instant gratification.
They cheered when his name came up.
It's like an audience participation type movie, too.
Yeah, it was cool. It was just really fun. Everybody kind of appreciated that I came home and stuff, and I did too, because I wanted to see it with my friends and family, not some Los Angeles.
Have you only
dummies.
Seen it in the theater once?
No, I saw it in Austin for the first time when it premiered at South by Southwest, and that was a theater of 1,200 people.
Was that fun?
It was so cool. It was rowdy, drunk Austin crowd.
That's what's cool about
it was time. So fun. It was like perfect audience to see that movie, and then. I got to do the audio commentary for the DVD. Which
really?
And they show you the movie while you're doing it, so you can comment on the movie. So that was cool, too. I never
That's
did
awesome.
Anything like that. Yeah.
Who'd you do the commentary with?
I did it with Fede, the director, Jessica Lucas, Jane Levy, and...
Who is Jessica Lucas in the film? Is she the main character?
She's the nurse. She's the one whose head I break open.
Okay.
And
I can't wait to see this movie.
It was justifiable head breaking open.
Can't wait to
see it. It's completely justifiable.
And she was trying to kill me.
Yeah.
She already made Jane is the main character. Face. Jane is really good. I gotta say, she's a really good actress.
She was
too. She knows her stuff. And I mean, for an actress to put herself through that and to do so well with all the choices that she made, all the sincerity in it, and the drama that's kept through the thing, even though it's total gore fest.
Yeah.
She really cared a lot, and she worked harder than every single one of us for the 3 months that we were there.
Is it harder to act when you have all of the crazy horror effect makeup on you?
Sometimes, and sometimes no. Because, if you know, the gash on my chest was easier to act because it looked so scary. Mm-hmm. It actually scared me. But sometimes, when you have a prosthetic on your face, which I did after the needle stuff, you can't be as expressive sometimes. But sometimes it works to your benefit because you find a different face out of it. And I had to close one eye because of that stuff. So all the injuries in the movie...
There's a lot.
They add to the character.
So many injuries.
Each time they sort of add to it.
Do you get to keep any souvenirs from that? Do you have one of your arms with a bunch of nails through it?
I probably shouldn't say anything, but I got my shirt. I was really excited because they didn't want to give anything away. Yeah,
why?
No.
They could put it all up on eBay or something?
Who knows? I don't know. It was just one of those things where they're making a big, high-class movie, I guess, much-anticipated film.
Yeah.
So things go on the internet. They go on eBay, and they don't want actors selling stuff from their movie or something and making money off of it. So what I really wish I had was a page from the book. That's what I wanted so bad. And, I just was looking at that book so many times, I could just rip a page out right now. Nobody would know. Nobody would know.
Nobody.
The pages in the book have they've pentagrams on them
and so cool
Gustave Doré and looking black and white illustrations of women being bathed in fire and their faces are melting off.
Those are my favorite books from every sci-fi or horror movie are the ancient scrolls that you get to go to because they don't really exist. All those visual things don't exist. It's all boring literature about it, but it's never good, visual stuff.
Those were pretty sweet scrolls. So are you going to do, are you going to go to any cons as a result of this film?
I went to WonderCon in California, Anaheim. So I went to that with, they wanted to do a panel with Bruce Campbell and the whole cast. So that was just the coolest thing ever.
Yeah.
I invited Bruce Campbell to the party I was having that night. He declined.
Did he politely
disrespectfully.
Decline? Oh.
Totally disrespectfully. Gave me the finger and said, F your party.
Did he say that at the panel or afterwards?
After the panel.
Oh, man.
But he made some damn good jokes, man. He's just such a host. He's done it for so many years, and he loves doing it. And people love when they get offended by him. When he offends people, they're like, I have been spit on by Bruce Campbell, which is like a kiss from God.
Wow. Good for Bruce Campbell. The crowd did go wild. After Lou's movie ends, Bruce Campbell comes on the screen for 1 second, and everyone went crazy.
Oh yeah.
It was this was Lou's family, Lou's friends, and the biggest audience reaction of the night wasn't any of the things that Lou did. It was when Bruce Campbell went on the stage and went groovy. Everyone was like, yes.
Yes.
And yeah. They enjoyed Lou. It wasn't that they didn't enjoy Lou, but there is something about
There's
Bruce
something
Campbell.
There's something about Bruce Campbell, man.
It's and that jawline, I think.
It's the chin.
Yeah.
Somebody wrote chin. About it. It was like a Thanksgiving ham. Chin like a Thanksgiving ham.
So are you going to do? Are you going to get to do more cons?
I don't know. I bet that I will in the future, and maybe not even the near future, but maybe just in the fact that this could be a franchise of the cult horror movie,
yeah.
Plus these next sequels, which I'm sure there's going to be
a
sequel to Evil
Dead.
Yeah,
there's got to be more of them, right?
There will be an Evil Dead 2, I'm absolutely sure. I know that Fede's already discussing writing it, so I know that it's in the works, and yeah. What he wants to do is really cool. He talked about it at the convention a little bit, so I know I could say something, but
okay.
He wants the two worlds to morph together. He wants to make the Bruce Campbell world morph into the Jane Levy Our Cabin world.
That'd be fun.
And I think that would be the coolest way to go about three or two more movies.
And then can you talk him into some sort of time travel for the third movie so that we can get you back in it?
God, I hope so. God, I'd love that.
That would work.
Time travel.
Yeah, I was thinking that, like, you could probably really milk this Evil Dead thing now. I bet when you're like, you're going to be like 50 and like fat and stuff, and you
Dude.
Can still just be at these and being like, $20 for me to sign my photo
That's
of me with the nails
do.
In me.
That's what they do.
Yeah.
At the convention, I heard that the girl who did, I guess, all of the stunt work for one of the girls on there charges $20 to get her autograph on the original Evil Dead, anything.
Yeah.
It's amazing. So yeah, I could be a big fatty.
Even get FaceTime.
I could just do whatever hell I want and just get some extra dough at these conventions.
Yeah,
that'd 50.
Be...
It's weird that this stuff is permanent. I don't really think about that usually because I've only been doing it for 10 years, so I still look the same. But
yeah.
When I start looking different, that's going to be freaky to go back and watch a movie from when I was 17 or something.
You're just
you know?
Going to have to not look different. You're going to have to Tom Cruise it.
That's true.
Find out what
that
Keanu Reeves
true.
Is doing, Lou.
Yeah, that's... I don't know what he's doing.
Do you, in some of the stuff that you've done, you were in the long-form Green Day video for Jesus of Suburbia.
12-minuter.
How often do you get recognized in that, from
More
that?
More often than you would imagine. It's crazy. Like, I don't know. It didn't really do very well, you know? Like, it was on Fuse a couple of times.
Yeah.
It didn't pick up like they wanted it to.
Well, it is a 12-minute video.
Yeah, totally.
I don't know how, like...
But they condensed it. It was a 6-minute, a 9-minute, and a 12-minute, even though
it
was the same video.
But all of those are really long. Like, they should have tried to make, like, a 3-minute there if they really wanted
true.
Airplay.
But that song is 6 minutes.
Yeah.
Itself. I think the song is actually 12 minutes itself.
That's a long one. It might even be, like, a series of songs, like, stuck together
mm-hmm.
that you wrote.
Yeah,
I think just so many people watched it on the internet.
Yeah, they did. It just became a real internet hit, but not really anything on, you know, the one that he did before that. I guess
mm-hmm.
was it? I don't think it was September Ends. I can't remember what it was, but
I think that was Wake Me Up When September Ends might have been after that.
Uh-huh.
It was probably American Idiot might have been the first video.
The one where the army guy comes home and it's like the two indie kids from India.
Is that Boulevard of Broken Dreams? I don't
know. Maybe. Anyway, that one got really big. Mm-hmm. He was, like, supposed to be in the army, and it was all about, you know, the war was going on and crazy stuff, so people were into it. And then we made that one, and it didn't hit.
You were just punk rock.
Yeah, I was just totally punk rock.
It's hit among my
friends.
It
hit in the right places, actually, because on the internet is where, like, it actually mattered. And I get recognized from that a lot. Yeah, totally.
Do people get mad that you don't have, like, a mohawk?
Yeah.
Or the
actually,
tattoos.
They do.
Tattoos,
a lot of people online, like, message me and say, why'd you change your hair? You looked so better when you had black hair, or you looked so punk rock when you had a mohawk and stuff. And I'm like, I guess. I like looking different, but.
Yeah. Sorry.
Sorry.
Sorry about that. I can't. My whole life's not a Green Day video.
Yes, that is true.
That is, I see every once in a while. Just like we're on Tumblr for the show, and every once in a while someone will just like reblog like photos of you on Tumblr.
Really?
Yeah, you know, it'll just be like punk rock, and it'll be like you. From
That's
there.
Awesome.
Yeah,
that's
it's
awesome.
It's really cool when that stuff happens.
I'm really excited by that. I mean, like to be in a lot of very cult-y sub-worlds
mm-hmm.
of this culture. You know, all these little subcultures, like the horror fans or the punk fans. That's where I'm a fan of all those things. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
And I like being a part of. the underdog culture, you know, the culture that's sort of coming up or something, or that nobody wants to pay attention to or whatever, or makes fun of in some way. It's more fun to be with those guys than to be.
Are you on any social media other than, you're on Facebook. Are you on like Instagram or Twitter, any of those?
I'm not on Instagram or Twitter, no. I have a Twitter. You should be. It's called The Real LTP.
The Real LTP. That sounds like a rapper.
I know. I'm actually starting my rap career soon, so hopefully I'll get some of that music on here next time.
What is The Real LTP?
This is my Taylor Twitter. Pucci.
Yeah, oh, it's your Twitter?
They're my Twitter, yeah.
You got to get on an Instagram.
I know.
That's the way to go
the
now.
The thing is, though, I'm, you know, I drink sometimes and I take
texting.
Pictures
yeah.
when I'm drinking. It's
yeah,
just,
no, don't.
I can't
do that.
Put that on the internet.
I'm thinking about getting rid of my Facebook because of that. I'm like, I'm incriminating myself sometimes.
James, you've been incriminated enough.
Yeah, I guess. Like, it doesn't matter.
You've already hit maximum incrimination at this point.
Now that I'm working for the man, especially with ABC. Disney sort of. I did a pilot for them mm-hmm. very recently.
The man, that's it. Yeah.
Working Disney's for
the man,
dude. They got all the cash and they hold all the reins.
Well, I mean, you don't even have to use your
big Disney.
Your Instagram that often, but I think that it would help you out if just every once in a while you were like, oh, here's me in front of my own movie poster.
You're
like,
right.
Isn't this weird?
You know something, you're right.
You would get a lot of followers from it.
If I did it every once in a while, I could probably pull it off. I'm just really bad at social media stuff. I've just been getting into Facebook because of all this stuff that's been going on with Story Luke, Evil Dead, all this stuff. Everybody's been asking me what's going on with you all the time. So I just figured if I just update this Facebook status all the time, then nobody will ask those questions.
Yeah, I think it'll
separately.
It'll keep people from asking you as many questions, but then it will keep you in the public eye.
Yeah, also, yeah, totally.
You know, because that's what you want. You want people to be following you enough where they're just like, well, we got to put Pucci in this movie because he's got 80,000 Instagram followers. Let's just throw him in.
That's true, man. It's true. That stuff actually matters now. It can change and shift a whole career to have a good Twitter.
Yeah, it must matter, especially if you're going to be in the sort of niche market, because that's like, that's what you need. You need like just like a photo. Oh, here's me hanging out with some fans at WonderCon.
I just hate being on the computer. I hate being on the phone so much. I've just grown up as that's the antithesis of what I think humanity should be about. So like, I try to shy away from it as much as possible, but I know that it's a necessary evil.
You could be the person on Instagram talking about how bad Instagram is, and like all of your, they could just be all like moody photos of you.
Yeah, moody photos. Yeah,
that's good. And then you could also you could really create like a sense of humility in yourself, like on your Instagram. If you it's like, oh wow, like here's like me getting to meet a celebrity. Yeah. Do that a couple times, everyone's gonna be like, wow, Lou's such a down to earth guy. Because in reality,
well, see,
in reality, folks,
no, I can't
he's
do it.
Not.
You already talked about it. Yeah. Now it's a plan.
Come on, nobody's going to see this. No one's going to see this. We understand.
Well, come on.
We have
people can see it on at 4.
Yes.
And 10.
Yes.
On Tuesdays and Fridays.
Yes.
A.M. and P.M.
A.M. and P.M.
So eventually, this might be on 8 times in 1 week.
Wow.
Unless it disappears. Our show from last week, the video survived, but the audio corrupted and then deleted itself.
No.
It was like some sort of James Bond self-destruct thing.
Oh, my God.
So we might, maybe one day, we'll redub the show. But I don't know how interesting that would be, because it was just an hour of James and I talking to each other.
Right.
And then it would just be James and I talking to each other about different things than we were actually talking. So that might be worse than when we were puppeteers.
How does this work, though? Is this like live streaming?
Yeah, we're live on the internet and HD radio right now.
Huh, I gotcha.
And then it's being filmed, and hopefully the audio is going into one of these cameras. We're thinking of this, but we thought it was last week, too. And then Jenna says we're good this time. She's guaranteeing it. So then Jenna edits it together, and then it either gets scheduled on time, in which case it's on Friday, or it doesn't get scheduled on time, then it'll probably be on Tuesday.
Nice.
And then it might be on both. And sometimes one just plays a lot. So this we'll try to make it be this one.
Yes.
Because obviously this is like way less awkward than the show usually is. Because usually it's at some point James is just staring at me for like a minute without speaking. Which that can happen in this one, but you're talking, so it's okay. Lou, have you gotten any When are the late night TV gigs going to start for you? Because this is a big movie.
Well, the thing is, it's a big horror movie, though. Horror movies are kind of seen more for their subculture and fans and things than for the acting involved.
Okay.
Even if it's good, it's still not really thought about that much.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm not expecting you to get on the actor studio from this, but, like, they bring on the people from, like, the Transformers
movies.
Well,
you know,
like,
what? It's hard to describe without giving away the end, because I don't live. You know,
that's
what I mean?
True.
But that's why there's,
you know,
some people kind of, they are doing some of it. Like,
oh, okay.
Morning TV
so,
shows
yeah,
and things like
of,
that.
Okay.
But that's more like, because it's going to lead up to sequels and things like that. So that's how the publicity wants to work on it. I'm hoping that this will get me to the boost where I can do a nice bigger movie where I am cast as a nice dramatic role, where then I could do some, you know, actual late night stuff, and it could be about, like, a really good job I did.
Yeah. I mean, you really did well in the
really
movie.
You really got stabbed in that movie.
Yeah, I know.
Awesome.
That's the thing. Everybody's like, oh, come on. It's just gore. It's just horror.
At one point, you're in water. How cold was the water?
Actually, it was warm,
really?
Which made it nasty. The crew had been walking through that water all day.
Oh,
it was
gross.
Filled
water.
With every type of chemical and foot that you could possibly put in it. And it was just absolutely disgusting and stinky. I said to the director, I love this movie. I will do it one time. One time I will go into the water. He was like, you don't have to do it. I said, no, I want to do it. I'll do it. It should happen. So we did it.
And it was gross.
It was gross.
But
and
it was
I got,
supposed to be gross, right?
Oh, yeah.
So
but I got some kind of nasty chemical cold afterward. Like something in my nose, like my sinus, like exploded or something. And the next day, I wasn't working, thank God. But I caught something terrible.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
That's gross.
You're
changing all my ideas of Hollywood. Every other interview I've ever heard, it's always the water was the coldest thing in the world.
Oh, yeah, totally.
It's always what it is. It's like, oh, yeah, well, we filmed the movie in Hawaii, but all of the water scenes, they put the water in ice.
It was cold before I got in the water, because what they would do was they'd spray us down with this, like, cold water so that we'd be shivering and so that the blood that had caked on us and dried would emulsion itself or something.
Okay, good word. Good word. Okay.
I don't know if I used that. I don't think that was correct.
We'll just go with it. We'll go with it.
Re-emulsify.
Yeah.
Hey.
So that really was you floating in the fetid.
That sure was.
The fetid gross water.
Fetid gross water.
And it really was gross water.
It really was gross
water.
Was
it movie magic?
Nope.
Yeah. The water didn't even look that gross in the movie.
They said Fede came up to me after. He's like, you stayed under there for 1.5 minutes. I was like, oh, my God. That's awesome. So 90 seconds I stayed under there because I did not want to do it again. I was like, this is not happening again, so I'm just going to go until somebody pulls me up or I die.
Unfortunately, you didn't die.
Yes.
You nearly caught that sinus infection.
Yeah.
So what other, what's on the horizon, the Lou Taylor Pucci horizon?
The Lou horizon.
Do you have like three more movies in the can?
Do you have a boat? Because
no.
You could name it that.
No, I don't have money. Come on. They haven't paid me for anything yet. I work for handshakes and sandwiches. That's all I work for. But hopefully I might get paid because, like I said, I'm working for the man right now.
Yeah.
And if this pilot goes, then, I mean, TV is where the cash just flows.
They pay
like
you in Mickey
like
Mouse dollars.
Beer. What? Mickey Mouse dollars.
No.
Mickey
you can
Mouse
only send
dollars.
It at Disneyland.
Yeah.
Well, you were on Girls, too, right?
Yeah.
But, like...
Yeah, that was fun. That
you
was
made
really
the mistake
fun.
Of not being the long-lasting boyfriend.
Oh, yeah. No, I...
People like that show.
I know. I wish I could get
I
back
get
on it.
It.
I wanted them to bring me back, but...
Maybe they can now.
I mean,
they could, because it's such a hit, they could kind of do whatever they wanted.
See, you know what, Lou? This is why you get an Instagram. You wear a Lena Dunham shirt every day, and you just take a photograph of yourself somewhere else. Like, pointing at it?
You're right.
You'll be on. You're just
right.
Like, hashtag bring Lou
she
back.
She really is cool, though. She is really cool.
She seems cool.
She directed it. She wrote
Writes
it. She
it.
Did every single thing involved. And while I was doing it, I had no idea she was directing. until like the third day we were working with each other, because she didn't act like the director.
You just thought she was yelling action?
No, she wasn't. That's the thing. She had a guy who was an assistant directing sort of for her, because she was on the screen all the time.
Yeah.
And the cinematographer who she talked to, I thought he was a director the whole time. He's actually a cinematographer. So pretty funny. But yeah, she did everything, and in such a cool way that I had no idea that it was even her. Like, no power trippy bull. It was just like she was cool and she knew what she was doing. Ultra creative and just ultra hyperactive, like, you know, able to be open about the dialogue. And what we created was sort of improv a lot of the time.
Okay.
A lot of the time. And that on an HBO show is crazy. It's just unheard of.
Except for Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Totally, which I love.
Yeah, that's maybe get on that show. Again, Instagram, put yourself in, like, yeah, you could try to be young Larry David.
You could probably do it.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
That could be your other rap name,
Young Larry
LTP,
David.
A.K.A. Young Larry David.
We tried to get Larry David here by giving him, like, a improv award.
Oh, that's awesome.
But I don't think
it didn't work.
God, that would have been cool.
That was one of James's smarter plans that he's come up with, though, is just that we pretend, we just make up awards and give them to people,
yes,
and then maybe one of them will show up.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, Scarlett Johansson's got a Lifetime Achievement Award. She's just waiting for her whenever she wants to show up and claim it.
God, that would be amazing.
So, to get back to it, Lou, what's on the horizon?
Did
we not
want
to talk about it too much?
No, it's great. It was called Reckless, but I don't think it's going to be called Reckless, because ABC somehow had two pilots that were called Reckless at the same time that were
okay,
that might happen.
One has two S's?
So, yeah, right? I have no idea.
One has a W and
basically,
one doesn't?
Basically, it's untitled right now, but it's about, you know, a person who is in another country and needs to, can't get home, and their
Liam
family
Neeson
is trying
to
get
them
home. No, Ernie Hudson is in it, though.
Nice.
Ernie Hudson, awesome. I couldn't believe I got
That's
to meet
awesome.
Him. He has humongous hands. Huge hands.
He just seems... He was in Oz, right? He was the warden in Oz?
Yes. Yeah. He was so good.
Yeah, he's a beast.
Yeah, and also J.K. Simmons was in Oz.
Okay.
I love him from Oz, too. Like, he was one of my favorite characters because he was so scary.
You just need to get to work. You got to work with Ryan O'Reilly now when he's not doing Mayhem.
Yeah, totally. So this Reckless pilot is pretty cool. Patrick Fugit from Almost Famous, the kid who is now... actually a man.
Okay.
Is a really good actor.
Man.
Really good actor. And Eloise Mumford. I think she's done some TV shows, especially
I've heard
like
of her
The
sons.
River. There's yeah. I have very, very nice. Very good.
What has she been in?
She's in a show called The River and many more things, I'm sure, but I don't know
anything.
I just don't watch TV.
I don't watch water related TV.
No, not at all. So,
this sounds like a drama.
It is a political drama.
Okay.
I would call it a political drama.
What's the political part that you're in? You're in a land
that they are
your
trying
own?
To get this woman back from another country through political channels.
Okay.
And so it's a very, you know, who do you know that can make this work? Who are the connections? And that's part of what it's about. I really can't give away the rest.
Yeah.
Do you get to travel?
I might. I'm not sure. We filmed it in New Orleans.
Oh, that's
and
cool.
That was cool. That was really cool.
Yeah.
But they had me, they set me, I was sober for 4 months, just totally sober, just because I wanted to, like, be super clean and, like, establish a routine and eat good food.
James has no idea what you're
doing.
It
was crazy.
Right
it was good. It made me feel amazing. But then.
We tried to do a cleanse and it
didn't. Cleanse. Yeah, honestly, I've never done one of those cleanses. I would never want to do that crap. But I've
really
tried.
Baby food.
I'm
one
really
baby
hungry
food.
Right now.
So. I did a fast in the woods. That was like a cleanse.
Yeah.
How long did you fast in the woods for?
4 days.
Wow.
It was good.
That sounds horrible.
It was intensely
that
good.
Used to be how they punished people.
I had a vision quest.
You got a vision
that
quest.
That was my vision quest.
Oh, okay.
Did you see Skunk Ape?
Skunk Ape. No, I didn't. I saw a giant porcupine.
No?
Immense porcupine. I forget what the hell I was saying. Now.
So you're doing the reckless thing, and then
so I get so I so I'm so no I so
sober.
I get totally sober. Mm-hmm. I do 4 months of sobriety, and then I get this pilot where they cast me as an alcoholic, as the alcoholic disappointment brother-in-law, and then put me in New Orleans on St. Patty's Day. I was like, what are you asking for here?
Yeah, I think they made it clear.
You can hang,
yeah,
I think
I promptly did my research, and. I painted the town green.
Not that we here at Brookdale would ever approve of that.
Absolutely not.
So you got that. You got Reckless coming up. That's one show.
Oh yeah.
Anything else? Do you guys have? Has there been?
This is it, man. This is all of it. It's all kind of happened at the same time. But in May, I'll find out whether Reckless gets picked up or not, or what it's called.
Untitled political drama.
ABC movie. Show.
Okay. Cool. And then, where are you living now?
I live in Los Angeles. It's kind of like a necessary evil. It's the only reason that I got Evil Dead was because I lived in Los Angeles. And that's, so I looked at it before that, but now I know I'm right. It's an investment to live there. That's it. It's just, the weather's great, but I mean, personally, I like the people and the culture of New York and New Jersey so much more in diversity and telling it like it is and not kind of being all cheesy and cliche and businessy all the time.
Yeah.
So, you know, Los Angeles has its awesomeness too with the weather.
Yeah, it got you in the Evil Dead.
It got me in Evil Dead. So, honestly, I'm looking at it as an investment. And when I can live somewhere else, I will. But I love it there right now.
Do you think maybe you can buy your own island one day, like Johnny Depp it?
I don't know about Johnny Depp it.
A really small island.
On Reckless, the driver... who was a old, he was a retired policeman from New Orleans, so he saw some stuff and he was telling me. But he also met Johnny Depp, and he said that guy was a blank hole. He was a blank hole. I was like, oh man.
Oh.
Oh man, really? Like yeah. He said Johnny Depp is terrible. He says he's a terrible guy, like treated everybody like crap. That's sad to hear.
Yeah, maybe Johnny was just having a bad day.
Maybe Johnny was having a bad day.
Maybe the driver was really
mean. He lived
in
France for
too long. No, the driver was so cool.
Oh, the driver was cool?
Yeah, no, he was really cool.
Okay, jeez.
I know, it was scary. I felt sad because Johnny Depp is like one of my favorite actors from when I was a kid. In fact, maybe if anything contributed to Story of Luke, I would say Edward Scissorhands sort of contributed to it, because if you sort of really take Edward Scissorhands' character apart, it's sort of an autistic character.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. That was deeper than I was expecting.
Yeah.
What about there was no What's Eating Gilbert Grape in it for you?
No. No. They also said, though, that he also met, what's his name from Titanic, you know?
Leonardo DiCaprio.
Leonardo DiCaprio, and said that he was the nicest guy they ever met. So.
So where do you fall in that?
I don't know.
I'm sure
I was in the middle somewhere.
Star.
Yeah. Chart. I gotta wait and see. He really does have a Star Trek. Maybe he just makes stuff up. Maybe he's just trying to cause drama between celebrities. He's just telling them.
Yeah. Johnny Depp versus Leonardo DiCaprio.
Alec Baldwin said you're awful. He called you a pig.
Yeah.
That's really cool, Luke. We are we're very proud of you.
Thanks, man. I'm very happy to like be doing some of the coolest stuff that I would want to go see in a theater. You know what I mean? Like that's what I wanted to do. I've always wanted to get to the point where I could get into the industry enough to do movies that I'd actually want to go see. Because I'm not really an independent film fan as much as like a action film fan. Like I love horror and action and stuff like that. So now I get to actually do something like that, and I'm excited.
Does it kind of happen?
Do you still have Stu's keys?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I stole Stu's keys. Jenna, can you give these keys to Stu? I robbed them from Brickdale Public Radio Stu Coogan like an hour ago.
Stu was probably running around for an hour looking for his keys. Like,
oh, my God.
Well, sorry, Stu. Well, they went to a good cause. Otherwise, we wouldn't have gotten in here, and then Lou's mic wouldn't have worked.
Oh, thanks, guys.
So, what about... Do you feel like you might get typecast in a good way from Evil Dead? Like, people are going to be like, oh, well, we got a movie with nails getting shot into people. It's
typecast. They definitely will try to put me in a lot of horror films that I'll have to say no to. Because it's just, it will typecast me if I do something silly like that. But at the same time, I don't think typecasting is the right word. I think it just gets into the audience mind that I could do bigger films and that you'd want to see me in bigger films.
Mm-hmm. So like bigger horror action,
bigger
type
anything,
films?
Just even just a bigger, you know, a love story or something that's, you know, has 40 million behind it, and they get to make it really good production value or whatever. It's just sometimes the best written scripts. Sometimes the best written scripts have the most money, and you want that character. You want to play that character because you could do it, but you're just not on that A list, so they don't want you because they don't think you'll bring in the fans.
Yeah.
now
that's why I have the Instagram.
So now it's nicer because I'm a little closer to that. I'm definitely taking
the
stuff
fans.
Up. Yeah.
Darren and I got recognized at our not Tent City benefit that we went to.
Right. Yeah, but the sound guy knew us. The sound guy looked like he would know who we were, though. He had like a big beard. He looked like us.
Yeah.
That we awesome. Also were mistaken for brothers at that thing.
Oh, and then God. Somebody said the band that I was in was really good, and I was really good at like whatever instrument the person thought I played.
Yeah, the guy thought he had just seen James do like a
great.
Sweet cover of like ZZ
Top. I just said, oh, thanks. And then some other guy, when Darren was like emceeing this silent auction, one of the guys like at the tables that was watching it was like, man, this guy's pretty good. He should be a comedian.
Yep, that's awesome.
I was like, I'm gonna tell him that.
Yeah, it's funny. He's the first guy to ever tell me that.
That's so good. Why were you going to a Tent City benefit?
It wasn't a Tent City.
It was supposed to. We thought it was. Our friend who used to come to improv did a benefit for Tent City last year, and she's doing one this year. And she was like, "Hey, do you and James want to host it as Check for Ticks and like, you know, keep it like kind of fun at the Tent City benefit?" So we said, "Yeah." And then I didn't talk to her, and then she was like, "Hey, you still good for that benefit like this month?" And I was like, "Yeah." And she had also. What I didn't realize was at another point she told me that her mother was throwing a benefit for a biker woman that had had a double lung transplant.
So that's what it was, but we almost, like...
So it was actually for the biker woman?
It was for the biker woman.
Yeah.
Oh my she was God. There. She looks like $1 million.
Oh. Yeah.
Okay. But James and I almost went up to this biker benefit and almost said, "Hey, everybody, thanks for coming out and supporting Tent City. It's really great that you did that."
Oh, God.
If we hadn't, we were so confused when we showed up.
I was confused.
Because
really
there were like 8 bikes on the side of the VFW and like all these like 45-year-old biker dudes.
Oh, my God.
And like we were supposed to be at an indie rock concert. So we were like, "Wait, what is going on?" So we were scared enough that we dawdled outside for long enough that we didn't have to intro the first band, or we would have said that.
Oh man, that's good.
Yeah, it would have been. It was like a Curb Your Enthusiasm episode. It was.
That was good.
Yeah, it was the kind of stuff that you would expect to happen to us.
We're right on par with being puppeteers behind a woman's couch.
Oh my God.
So Lou, if this Untitled Reckless project keeps up, and there's any sort of bearded extra characters that are needed.
Oh, man, you are so in. It's
bearded
just
bad
crazy.
Guys. I think James and I could do it. Don't give me any speaking words.
I won't.
No
I
speaking.
Wouldn't. Come on.
Yeah. But I, you know, I could talk. I could probably die convincingly. Or at least get arrested.
Dying is harder than you think.
Yeah,
man.
It is. Well, because that's
dying.
You only get to do it once in real life, you know?
Well,
so,
yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So you don't really get practice.
Yeah. That's it.
I had to do some dying, though.
All right, maybe I can't even die. Maybe I can just be in the background while somebody else dies.
You could get stabbed and die off camera.
Yeah, I could do that.
That's a good one, actually, because then people are excited because they're like, "What happened to the guy that got stabbed?"
Oh.
You never know.
Oh, yeah.
The mystery.
That's great. And then maybe I can get my own spinoff.
Oh, yeah.
The guy that got stabbed.
Yeah. And I just go to different places and I get stabbed. So are you going to be teaching any more classes?
Oh, man, I really hope so. I know that it'll be in my future. I just don't know how close. This is a wave that you have to ride sort of with any – when you get momentum with this career, it's just you have to keep on it.
You got to Instagram
it. So I am just keeping on it as much as I can right now.
Yeah, you do a lot of – you work all the time. Like,
yeah, I've been running pretty ragged. And I love it. I really like doing what I'm doing. So I just want to be able to do more. I want to have more options to play better characters for more people.
Yeah.
And that's sort of what the whole job ends up being about once you get into it. Once you're lucky enough to get in, it's like, how do I do the parts that people want to do?
Well, you certainly did one in the Evil Dead movie.
Thanks. Yeah.
And that's it. We got to get out of here.
All right.
Thanks, guys.
I'm going to go watch Evil Dead.
Yeah, James is going to go watch it.
Please go see it.
So let's get us some music, James. So this isn't too...
In the UK, people who work...
Where start the intro again?
90.5 WBJB, HD3, Lincroft, Middletown, Brookdale Student Radio, where you can be the DJ.